Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Yesterday's teaching snippet, I talked about the power of our words, of course. We're still in our little booklets here. And I was talking a little bit about how our tongue is a rudder. It's a small instrument, but it directs our lives wherever we go. I see my life as this big ship, and my little bitty tongue gets to decide where it lands. Am I going to go into some rough waters or smooth sailing? I also, at the end of that video, talked about an apple experiment that Courtney and I did, and we bought these two apples that looked identical, wrote good words on one, bad words on another when we got them home that day. 3 weeks later, the one apple that had good on it was edible. It was still okay. It had life. And that other apple was shriveled and rotting and had mold on it. It's the exact same age, and it wasn't even edible anymore. You can go on the internet and just type in experiments with words, and you'll get just all kinds of stuff. They have done experiments with water, just the same water, okay? But they'll speak good things over some of the water, and under the microscope, it'll look a certain way. And then they'll speak curses and mean stuff over it and look at it under the microscope, and it'll look totally different. There's another one out there where plants are huge. You should try this, and that way you will convince yourself, just like I did, that words are important. I was listening to one of my Bible teachers, and his name is Andrew Womack. And you can go to this website. It's under AWMI for Andrew Womack Ministries International, AWMI.net, and pull this up. It's called The Power of Faith-Filled Words. The Power of Faith-Filled Words. That is worth your 4 hours of investing in listening to him teach that. It will shock you. But I want to tell you a little excerpt out of his teaching. He was talking about the scientist went to a greenhouse, I guess at a landscape company or something, and they put little electrodes on the plants that was in this greenhouse. A man comes in, and he's cussing and screaming, and he picks up one of the plants and tears it to pieces. And the little plants that had the electrodes hooked to them, the electrodes are just going bonkers. Later, like the next day, and they did this experiment for a few days, maybe 2 or 3 weeks. Anyway, other people would come in and just be talking to each other calmly. Now, the electrodes did pick up, and they moved, but they were very calm. This man comes back much later, the same man, and this time he's not angry. His voice is level, and he's not speaking anything mean or anything. Did you know those electrodes went just as bonkers as they did when he was cussing and screaming and tearing a plant apart? I'll throw this one in for free. I have been around people that are extremely mean and angry and even violent, and my little electrodes inside me went bonkers. And most of the time, when I was around them and they weren't tearing anything up and cussing and screaming, did you know inside of me I was still in a sense of unrest? So I would encourage you to guard your words. And please don't tell me that you can't help what you say when you're angry, because number one, Jesus said that you were accountable for the words that you would say, so obviously you can control them, and you can control your temper. I know that you can. I've seen people get in front of a police officer, and that same violent person that was hitting someone turned into a completely different person. So, yes, we can control our temper when it's in our own best interest. Today I want to get in scripture real quick before I close. I want to talk to you about the people you hang around with. And it's like, oh, that's not important. Oh, my friends, you could not be any more wrong. I used to tell my youth group, and I was a youth leader for several years, that they had to pick their friends wisely. And many of them explained to me, because, you know, I hadn't lived much, right? that it didn't matter who they hung around with, that they could run around with kids that were sleeping with other, with, you know, active sexually. They could be friends with people who drank, did drugs, and cussed all the time. It wouldn't affect them. But you know, that's not what the Bible says. The Word of God says that you should not be unequally, that means binded together, unequally yoked with someone who's different from you. Well, that's because you're going to become what they are. Yes. And you don't want to become just any old person, right? But I want to go over to 1 Corinthians 15:33, and I want to show you what the Bible says here. It says, do not be fooled, deceived, or misled. Bad friends and bad company will ruin good habits, good character, and good morals. Okay, so there's no such thing as small talk. You cannot just go out and say anything you want to, hang around people that say anything they want to, and you not get that mess on you. Let me throw this one in for free. Did you know when you watch TV, a sitcom, a comedy, did you know that there are over 15 lies in every single sitcom? The things that entertain us and make us laugh is based on deception, deceiving other people and lying to them. Do you think that that's a mistake? That they're putting that out there to make that what we're entertained by? No, they're training us to be liars and to deceive the people who are in our lives. And I'm not trying to get too critical here, guys. I'm just trying to tell you why sometimes we land where we are in life. And I want to pull you out of that ditch and get you set back on a good path. Well, I'm going to close now. So God bless you, and I'll see you right here again on Facebook.